The array modifier offers several ways to adjust the distributed copies. The first is the transform rollout, which lets you modify the position, rotation, and scale of the array copies. The default all method applies the same adjustment to all copies. Local rotation rotates each copy around its original pivot. World rotation rotates the entire array as one unit around the object's pivot. The scale option includes a scale link button for uniform scaling. Here's an example of the power of the transform an array feature. I created roof shingles using the box and a bend modifier, then added an array modifier. To prevent the shingles from overlapping, I needed to slant each one. By using transform an array, I could adjust the rotation while viewing the final result. Additionally, I could align the bottom of the shingles with the ground plane. There are various transform types available. The methods supported depend on both the distribution type and the transform type. Incremental moves or rotates each copy by an additional cumulative amount. For instance, if you set the local rotation to 5 degrees on the x-axis, the first copy will rotate 5 degrees around the x-axis, the second copy will rotate 10 degrees, the third copy 15 degrees, and so on, increasing by 5 degrees with each subsequent copy. Alternating transforms every other copy. This method is useful for creating bricks, hexagon tiles, and similar items. By axis treats the copies of the given axis as one body. You can see the copies along the same x-axis are rotating together, and the rotation angle is getting bigger along the y-axis or the y and z-axis. Incremental by axis is opposite of by axis. It rotates only along the adjustment axis. These four methods are the most common ones. But there are also a few interesting methods. Grid position has a z by y configuration, incrementally raising each y row along the z axis, similar to how stadium seating is arranged. Grid rotation features a random increment option, which rotates copies by a random multiple of the specified value. For example, setting ZZ to 90 will rotate each copy by a random multiple of 90, resulting in rotations of 0, 90, 180, or 360 degrees. This is ideal for creating a truchet pattern. Radial distribution comes with its own set of position adjustments, including axial, radial, and ring settings. Creating a spiral staircase with axial offset is very easy. It also features radial phase and ring phase for animation purposes. Radial phase rotates every other row in the opposite direction, while ring phase rotates every other ring in the opposite direction. Radial rotation and scale offer a progressive option, which is similar to incremental. But instead of defining the increment amount, it defines the end angle or scale. Lastly, let's look at the transform before projection option for spline surface projection. For the array modifier, the process order is: first, it distributes the copies. Next, it transforms the distributed copies. And finally, it randomizes them. This means that the copies wouldn't align with the target surface if you transform them because they are transformed after projection. Look at this gap after transform. Enabling transform before projection allows for transformation first, followed by projection. This ensures that the copies are projected onto the surface. In the real world, nothing is uniform or perfect. Randomness brings things to life and makes them appear natural. The randomization rollout gives you complete control over randomizing transformations along each axis. It includes an apply percent parameter to set the percentage of copies that are randomized. You can temporarily turn off randomization by setting this parameter to 0%. I'm not sure if you noticed, but in the distribution rollout, we skipped the array by element options to focus on the distribution types in the past tutorial. These options allow each element of the base object to be used as a source for the array. As I previously stated, an array and a scatter are distinct concepts. You cannot select multiple source objects for copies in an array, as an array distributes itself. However, the array by element feature helps mitigate this limitation to some extent. This is the base object, which consists of three elements. With array by element enabled, you can see that only one element is used for each copy. The elements are picked randomly because the picking method is set to random. However, the gap between copies appears incorrect, because each element is still in its original local position. Setting the offset to 0 will reveal this. To correct it, we need to center them at their own center. The Center By option allows you to center each element along the specified axis. Turn on the x-axis and you'll see the element centered along it. Next, try turning on the y-axis as well. We don't need to center along the z-axis since all elements already have their centers at the bottom as needed. Now, set the offset back to 1. It looks better, but you might still see a gap. This is because the bounding box size is determined by the largest dimension of all elements along the axis. In this case, the sphere's x-axis size is used. You can confirm this by changing the pick method to ordered, which repeats the elements along the specified axis. If you set it to ID, it repeats based on the copy ID. First, middle, last uses the first and last elements at the beginning and end, filling in the middle randomly with the remaining elements. The order follows the vertex order of elements. In this case, the order of addition to the Boolean object determines the sequence. So, the box would be first, and the tube would be last. Here is a useful option to remember: the pack elements option for the grid fill method. For example, I have a book with its pivot aligned at the bottom back. I generated 10 copies with random scales using an array modifier. Now I want to fill a shelf with these 10 books. So I applied another array modifier. I changed the layout method to fill and set the width to 300. Then I turned on array by element and center by x and checked pack elements. Try adjusting the width value, and you will see that the array modifier automatically adjusts the distribution to adapt to the width of each book. The pack elements checkbox tightly packs clones along the x-axis. When the offset is set to 1.0, there will be no gap between the copies. If you set the offset to 1.5, the gap will vary according to the width of each copy. Now, the material ID rollout. As you might expect, this lets us assign new material IDs to the copies. By default, the Ignore Existing IDs option is off, so it preserves the IDs from the source if you don't want to change them. Turn on the option. Now, everything has an ID of 1, because both the from and the to are set to 1. If you set the to to 5, the copies will get a random ID between 1 and 5, as the randomization method is set to ID. Try changing the from and the to 3 and 7. The copies will get random IDs between 3 and 7. Changing the seed value will alter the randomization. The end times option allows an ID to repeat the given times. Try to set it to 3, then change the phase value and cancel. This is necessary because the modifier doesn't update immediately after some values change. This action will trigger a reevaluation of the modifier. If you choose to randomize through only one axis, the copies will get a random ID only along that axis. Similar to array by element, material ID also supports ordered and first, middle, last. Ordered applies the given material IDs sequentially, either along the specified axis or the clone IDs. The phase feature allows cycling through the assigned material IDs. This is an example of creating a simple marquee animation by adjusting the phase value. For first, middle, last, you set the first and last IDs and specify the range for the middle IDs using the from and to parameters. The UV option in the array modifier is both interesting and powerful. It allows us to generate different UV values for each clone. When combined with OSL, it opens up many possibilities. By default, the setting is existing, which means it simply uses the current UVs without any changes. The clone XYZ option maps the nth value along each axis of the clone to UVW. For example, if I have a grid array with 5 clones along the x-axis, the first clone will have the values 0, 0, 0. The second will have 1, 0, 0. And the third will have 2, 0, 0. If the normalize option is enabled, the values will be normalized for each axis. Thus, the bottom right corner would be 1, 0, 0, and the top left would be 0, 1, 0. This is a default 2D grid with clone XYZ and normalize enabled. You can see that it is automatically mapped to a 2D image. Switching to clone number assigns the nth number to the U value while V and W remain 0. When normalized, this creates a red gradient from the first to the last clone. If additive is checked, it merges the clone data with the source UV and outputs it to the specified channel. For instance, if you add clone XYZ back to UV1, you can create an offset UV for each clone. Remove removes the clones by a specified percentage. Alternatively, you can use an include object to either delete or retain them. All right, this is the last rollout. You can create individual objects for each clone by pressing the Create Object button. This action will generate a layer named with the original object's name, followed by an underscore and clones. Each clone object will have a name consisting of the original array object name, followed by an underscore and a 3-digit number. By default, the Use Instance option is enabled, meaning the base object will be instanced and will have its own transformations from the modifier. However, if you have used any UV or material ID options, instancing will not be possible because the mesh data will differ. This concludes the features of the array modifier. In the next lesson, we will explore how to use all these great features together. Thanks for watching.